Hi guys, Video Jesus here. I'm going to try to do this in a one-hit wonder, give you a little bit of video basics 101, just so everybody can kind of follow what I'm saying in the Sallyport. So let's get started. So this is just going to be a basic tutorial that we'll do tonight and some of the basic foundations that we're going to be talking about, which is going to include frame rates, compression, coding, and decoding. It's also going to include group of pictures. So I'm just going to give you a good basic foundation. So some of the research and background that went into this, I originally was really interested in the Sallyport camera after I saw this in trial. My mother lives in Massachusetts. She sent me this crazy trial about Karen Reed and how a video was altered. And I looked at it and 100% at the time, like, this is edited. And I do have a compression background, video engineering background, and I've also been in the production field for over 20 years. So I did see this video and 100%, I was fairly certain off the bat that it was altered. But with anything with editing, kind of put in all the factors at hand, and that includes the camera, what it was filmed with, knowing what the sensor, different lighting situations, including overexposure, underexposure, how the lens functions in regards to aperture. So a lot of these security cameras have fixed apertures. And then in relation to of what the frame rate settings are. So we saw a lot of ghosting images, which is actually very well explained in regards to compression and how that compression works in forms of GOP. So we'll be discussing that tonight. So let's get started. All right, so let's talk about frame rates. I know this is not microdots. It's a little nerdy, so bear with me, but let's get the basics down first. So frame rate, simply put, is a number of frames or images that appear per second of a video. And the frame rate is really measured by what we call FPS, so frames per second. The more frames in each second of a video, the smoother the action. On the other hand, the fewer frames could also result in jerky or motion blur. Many security cameras allow users to adjust the recording frame rate. Lowering the frame rate can improve the network streaming and conserve storage space. Conversely, the higher the frame rate, the better the quality, but also the larger file size that the video is going to be. So think of it this way. The lower the frame rate, the lower the file size. The higher the frame rate, the larger the file size. So if I was in a non-linear editing software program like Premiere, I had a 15 frame per second video and I put it into a 2997 sequence or even higher, what's going to happen when we get into the GOP in the next slide is going to add frames in the export. So adding frames to 15 frames per second. So if it's 15 frames per second, I export it 2997, it's going to add frames to each second. But what we're going to do now is we're going to watch a simplified explanation, just showcasing some of the different frame rates that security cameras have the capability of doing per the user settings. So let's play this video.
The purpose of this video is to compare various recording frame rates that can be used in closed circuit television and network IP based video surveillance systems. This is a side-by-side comparison of video that was recorded at 30, 15, 7.5, 5, and 1 frame per second. When planning a video surveillance system, the frame rate that the DVR and cameras support is one of many things to consider. In our experience, recording between 7.5 and 15 frames per second is the most common. This is because very little quality is lost, as you could see here. Once you start going below 7.5 frames, the choppiness is much more noticeable to the human eye.
So in a nutshell, that's what we're talking about as far as frame rates and recording. So Axis cameras, you can film anywhere from 1 to 2.997 frames per second. Why is this important? And this really goes into what we're going to be talking about next, which is wrappers and flavors. We're referring to the encoding and decoding process. And we'll get into that in this one. So what is compression? So a video codec shrinks or compresses a digital file to be more easily stored and distributed. Codecs have two main components, an encoder and a decoder, that works together to make a video file size more manageable. An encoder, the encoder is part of the codec that handles the actual compression of the file. And this is what we refer to as a codec flavor. There are many flavors across the board. A decoder is a component of a video codec which prepares the file for viewing after it's gone through the compression. It decompresses it into a specific video container. And we call this, and we will refer to this as a file wrapper. And so just to put this in more of an analogy, let's imagine a world without video codecs. Uncompressed audio and video files can take a huge amount of storage, especially for lengthy recordings. Without video codecs, you'd essentially have to wait minutes or even hours to watch videos on YouTube because of the enormous file size. And this is what codecs and wrappers help us with in order for us to stream better, to store files better, and to be able to get better quality in what we're exporting and encoding and decoding. So a codec uses an algorithm that determines the best way to shrink the size of your video file while still keeping keeping everything intact. So let's get into codec flavors. So there are many different type of codec flavors, and that includes H.264 and more recently the H.265, which is the HEVC, high efficiency video encoding codec flavor. Other types include AV1, MPEG-4, MPEG-2, VP9. So these codecs really refer to how the video stream itself is compressed and encoded, and essentially how the stuff, quote, stuff in data is laid out in the box container. Common codecs include H.264, which is really what we're talking about in the Sallyport. Get into video wrappers. So I just want you to think of video wrappers as containers, different formats for wrapping a package. Just like you might use a cardboard box padded with an envelope or gift wrap to package an item. Video containers wrap up the encoded video streams in different ways depending on their use. You're probably familiar with image formats like JPEG. Similarly, video files use special formats. Some of the most common packaging formats are MP4, MOV, and AVI containers. So now let's get to MP4, which is more widely supported container that focuses more on live stream. So just think of Vimeo or YouTube, Twitter, Meta. They all use MP4s in a lot of their decode and encode. So when we're talking about Equivision, which is a lot of what I posted about, records a video in an H.264 flavor, which is what our last slide was about, was more of the codecs. And this records and uses a proprietary wrapper, which is called an EVX. And that's when we go to codec wrappers. So an EVX is a proprietary wrapper that Equivision uses to, again, wrap the video stream, it's then packaged into an EXE. And this format packages the video data along with a built-in player, allowing the player on Windows systems without requiring additional software, which is kind of what we also saw in court with the three screenshots that I posted on Twitter. But this is essentially at the foundation where the Sallyport, in addition to how it functions with Equivision, is recorded and how it's also exported. And this is particularly useful in sharing clips with users that do not have Equivision installed. So I just want to put that out there for the people that are wondering how all of these things are related. This is the two foundations of how all of these things come together in one EXE. So now let's get to group of pictures, which is a very complicated technical concept, but it's actually pretty easy to understand when, you know, you kind of get down to the nitty-gritty of it. Group of pictures is composed of IBP frame structure. Different codecs, which we call flavors, have different algorithms that determine this. There's long form GOP and then there's short form GOP. Think about GOP, the iframe is used to predict the first P frame, and these two frames are also used to predict the first and second B frame. Okay, so I know what you're thinking, this is super confusing. So let's break down what an iframe is, a P frame is, and a B frame is. GOP, the first frame, behaves like a complete picture, such as a photograph. It is able to be encoded and decoded on its own. Everything necessary to display it is inside the iframe. So think of this as a full picture. P frames and B frames are more what we would like to refer to as motion frames. Now let's talk about a P frame. So P frame means predicted frame. These frames only save the difference motion vectors between themselves and the former frame, usually the iframe. This significantly reduces the file size, as most video sequences exhibit significant redundancies between frames due to movement. This is also called temporal redundancy, and we will get to this when we start talking about the ghosting frame artifacts that we've seen in the Sallyport. Now let's talk about B frames, bi-predicted frames. The B frames are more densely compressed than the P frames, and they are more compressed by taking information not only from the preceding times, but also from the future times within the GOP. These frames can achieve the highest compression ratio, but it should also be noted that B frames are also the most dependent on the surrounding frames for accurate decoding, which is why B frames arguably is one of the most important frames because they are such densely compressed. So let's talk about GOP length. A short GOP length will generally help improve video quality and improve random access and error resilience and make the video easier to edit since it has more frequent iframes. The more iframes in a video will allow more points for clean cuts. Remember this, more points for clean cuts and edits without depending on many subsequent frames. However, shorter form GOP will use more bits and bit rate to maintain a higher quality. And this is important to note when we're looking at security camera footage. Long form GOP is generally better for compression it produces smaller file sizes or a lower bit rate at the expense of potentially decreased error resilience and fewer opportunities for the user to do edits. So again, if we're going back to types of GOP, short length GOP is really great for editing. It will provide more clean cuts without depending on many subsequent frames. Long form GOP, which is where we add more P and B frames, is going to decrease the file size and achieve a lower bit rate, but it's going to be at the expense of potential decrease in error resilience and fewer opportunities for the user to do edits. So it's really important to know in the Sallyport. And that's really important to know of why we can see these clear cuts where the picture does not make sense as a form of, even if this was just natively exported, right? The one downside of GOP is compression and temporal artifacts. iframes, like complete standalone photos, every frame contains a full image. They're reliable, resistant to visual errors over time, but do require more storage, which we covered. So there are some codecs that will do all iframes, which is great. The picture is awesome, but the file size is massive, and it is massive for playback, and it's just not really practical in everyday use, especially in particular for a security camera. This is an H.264 codec. So when we start talking about P and B frames in relation to temporal artifacts, think of it like a flipbook that only draws changes between pages. Efficient for storage, but small errors in one frame can ripple through the others. And this creates visible distortions. We call these visual distortions temporal artifacts. And these include anything from motion inconsistencies to blurring. For example, what can happen is if you are editing something that's 15 frames per second, it has a long form GOP or even a short form GOP, once you make the cut, you might be able to see ghosting from the preceding predictive or bi-predictive frames.
So why I know this was cut is because if we just slow down this clip, so let's look at this motion. It's a lot of movement going in. And particularly if we had a 15 frame per second, security camera recording frame rate, we would expect to see if there was something, again, maybe there was some disruption in the file. We would expect to see some of these artifacts that we're looking at now, right? Because we're seeing these people that are walking and it's cutting on that kind of motion. So this isn't a natural in relation to what we can look at here. So if there was a problem with the file, we wouldn't get this smooth motion. So we see the car coming in. It's probably the fastest thing in this scene throughout the whole Sallyport is when the car pulls into the garage. We don't see any temporal distortion because we see this temporal distortion when we're cutting on something, which means that we're cutting on a frame or a predictive or a bidirectional frame. The editing program, because I do believe that this was edited in After Effects, I don't believe they match the native frame rate, because if it was a 15 frame per second clip, we wouldn't be adding P and B frames. But for some reason, this video is adding P and B frames, which is really, really key to the reason why this video is edited.
For example, some of these frame rate challenges can come into play when we are working with group of picture codecs. And in particular, for example, say this is, can be applied to security cameras, but say you're filming something on your iPhone and your frame rate is 15 frames per second and you put it in a 2997 timeline or even a higher frame rate timeline. What you're doing is you're doubling or tripling P and B frames. So we're making more P and B frames because we only have a limited amount of iframes. And this is what causes a ghosting, almost like a comet trail. It's almost like doubling pages of a flipbook by guessing and adding new ones between the originals.
And I totally get it. Like, this isn't as exciting as microdots, but it's really important to understand why these temporal artifacts occur in compression, and also gives you a really good idea of the fact that this video is 100% edited. And you can literally tell that by the artifacts. So everybody's homework tonight is to go back to the Sallyport, go to microdots. They posted, I think, on Twitter, and look at any cut that you see and you'll see that temporal artifact. And again, that's from putting it into an editing program that was probably not at the native frame rate, and that occurs when you add B and P frames. Next time we'll cover compression and how they were able to replace the proprietary codec in Equivision. So hopefully that explains everything. I mean, this was a very hard video to make. I know it's super boring, but it's kind of interesting if you actually look at the tech behind it. A little bit more interesting than how's long to die in the cold. Because I'm not going to lie, I did not understand that, and I just cashed out. So hopefully this video doesn't make you lally to death. But we'll cover more exciting things in the next video. So cheers.